This is a common birdseed mix most people buy, but it's a big mistake. The past 5 years have taught me so much about feeding backyard birds, from possible dangers, food preferences, bird gangs, cleaning routines, and unwanted visitors. These are 10 things to expect and mistakes to avoid when feeding backyard birds. Number 10. Which birds will show up? It helps to know what birds to expect before buying food. Don't waste money on food for birds that don't live in your area. Some companies print a chart on the food bags, but these are not always accurate. One place to check out is the Explore page on ebird.org. It will tell you about specific birds or give you a list of all birds that live in your region. For a more specific list of what to expect, Project Feeder Watch has backyard feeding information. Feeder Watch is a winter survey of birds that visit the United States and Canada. The birds are sorted by region, food type, and even type of feeder. Clicking on a particular bird will reveal more about what they eat and the types of feeders they like. There's also a variety of books you can check out. If you have any specialty wild bird food stores in your area, they can also be a resource for finding out what food to buy. Number 9. Filler seeds. Several food options exist today with a range of price points. The problem is, some can be a waste of money. The cheaper options often contain filler material. You might see bags with lots of this red seed. It's called Milo. Look at all that dust. The label on this mix mentions grain products, sunflower, calcium carbonate, and some vitamins. The reality is it contains a great deal of Milo, cracked corn, corn powder, and only a bit of sunflower seeds. This picture is from a 20-pound bag of mixed seed at a big box store. Look at all that Milo. At least 75% of this mix has to be Milo. Also avoid mixes that contain wheat, oats, flaxseed, canary seed, and large amounts of red or white millet. Some birds love millet, such as downy woodpeckers, but it was usually the only seed left in my feeders at refilling time. Suet cakes might also contain these fillers. This cake's label says rendered beef suet, cracked corn, millet, peanut pieces, and there it is again, processed grain byproducts. These filler seeds end up tossed to the ground as the birds sort out what they want. Even worse, the seeds might begin to spoil, especially corn. Large amounts of spilled seeds might attract unwanted visitors, such as rodents. This picture looks like all grass, but some of it is actually Milo growing under the bird feeders. One plant had even been pulled up, showing the seed at the root of the plant. Number 8. Already cracked. Peanuts and sunflower seeds grow with a shell around the nut or seed heart. The downside is that sunflower hulls will kill grass under the feeders if the hulls are left to accumulate. If lots of sunflower-eating birds are coming to the feeders, then cleaning up the mess becomes part of the routine. There is an alternative. Look for bags of sunflower or peanuts with the shell already removed. The catch is the price. They are more expensive than their regular versions. If the higher price isn't an issue, the cleanup routine around the feeder area will be easier. A word of caution, without the shell, sunflower seeds and peanuts will spoil more quickly. Number 7. Red dye. Prepackaged hummingbird nectar is often sold with a red dye. The dye is added with the thought that it will help attract the hummingbirds, since they like the color red. The truth is, they don't need red dyed nectar. Naturally produced nectar is already clear, and some flowers hummingbirds like aren't even red. They were even drinking from this sunflower head, although I wasn't able to capture it on video. Most hummingbird feeders already feature red parts, such as these plastic saucer-style feeders. Red dye number 40 is a common coloring dye used in hummingbird nectar, although in recent years, some companies have switched to fruit-based red coloring. Rather than take a chance on the hummingbird's health, it's probably best to err on the safe side and just offer them clear nectar. Number 6. Absent birds. Even though websites, such as Project Feeder Watch, might suggest certain birds live in your area, they might not visit your feeders. That's because it's possible your yard isn't their preferred habitat. One bird I wanted to see at my feeders is the eastern towhee. According to Project Feeder Watch, they like sunflower seeds, cracked corn, peanut hearts, millet, and Milo. But there's one problem. My yard isn't their preferred habitat. Eastern towhees like to hang out in dense undergrowth, rummaging around in leaf litter, searching for insects, spiders, and snails, to name a few non-seed food options. Number 5, predatory birds. As the populations of hawks and falcons have rebounded over the past few decades, the chances of seeing these predatory birds in your backyard have increased, not only in rural areas, but also in the suburbs and cities. According to Project Feeder Watch data, Coopersock sightings near feeders occurred at just 6% in 1989, but had increased to 25% by 2016. Researchers speculated that during winter, when hawks are not nesting, their main concern is finding food. Areas with fewer trees usually have higher human populations and bird feeder density, which equals more songbirds. These areas create a food source not only for backyard songbirds, but also for the hawks. If you are bothered by frequent hawk activity around your yard, try taking down your feeders for a week. The hawks might begin to look elsewhere. On the other hand, the fact that hawks are visiting at all is a sign of a healthy birds of prey ecosystem. Number 4, bird gangs. Some species of birds are solitary, eating alone. Others arrive in family groups, mixed flocks or pairs. What most of us don't want to see are gangs of birds having a block party at our feeders, cleaning them out in a short amount of time. This often happens when the weather turns colder, in the late fall, winter, and into the early spring. The usual suspects include European starlings, house sparrows, rock pigeons, common grackles, and sometimes brown-headed cowbirds, mourning doves, and red-winged blackbirds. In order to limit crowds of these birds, you have to change the food offerings. If black oil sunflower seeds are going too fast, try offering the striped version. They are larger than the black oil type and are harder to crack. Safflower is a tough, bitter-tasting seed that most birds don't like, but northern cardinals seem to love. Pigeons and doves need larger feeders, so either limit their favorite foods or take down these feeders temporarily. Switch out suet cakes, which are soft, for seed cakes, which are harder for starlings and house sparrows to eat. Using an upside-down suet feeder instead of a standard one will slow down suet consumption. Another option is a pure white suet cake. These are harder to find, but starlings are not a big fan of them. Organizing food types by feeder can also deter these groups from taking over. Sunflower hearts and crushed nuts in a clingers-only style feeder, sunflower seeds, nuts, and fruit in a small hopper style feeder that large birds can't easily perch on. If all else fails, try bringing in your feeders and see if the unwanted crowds disperse. Number 3, cleaning. If large numbers of birds are eating at your feeders each day, they will need frequent cleanings. Remove droppings every time you refill and do a thorough cleaning at least once a month. If feeders and surfaces are really dirty, then once a week might be required. Dirty feeders and baths can spread viruses, bacteria, and salmonella through droppings and saliva, so it's important to clean. Remove any debris, including droppings or uneaten seeds or shells. Old and wet seed can harbor bacteria and mold. Also check the poles and baffles for cleanliness and the ground for a buildup of uneaten seeds, shells, and droppings. Mix 9 parts water to 1 part bleach. Wear gloves. Of course, avoid getting bleach on clothing and in your eyes. Consider wearing eye protection. Soak the feeders for at least 5 minutes if you can. Scrub if necessary and rinse off the bleach. Make sure to let the feeders completely dry before refilling. Hummingbird feeders require more frequent cleaning. The nectar should be changed every 3 to 5 days, most frequently during periods of hot weather. The nectar should always be clear. If it turns cloudy, dump it out and clean the feeder. The same water and bleach method can be used. The same applies to bird baths. Birds not only take baths, but they also use the bath to take drinks. The water gets dirty and filled with feather oil, pieces of food, and droppings. Use the same water and bleach solution to clean the bath. Also check for the presence of algae, which might grow below the waterline. If present, make sure it gets scrubbed away. Thoroughly rinse away the bleach before refilling the bath. Number 2. Stinging visitors. If you offer sweet treats, such as jellies, fruit, and sugar water during certain times of the year, you're certain to attract yellow jackets, wasps, hornets, and bees. This is likely to happen from late spring through early fall. Another video detailing what you can do about these visitors is in the description below and will appear at the end of this video. Number 1. Other visitors. If you have feeders on the ground or even just lots of spilled seed, you'll start to see more squirrels show up. And beyond that, other visitors might appear, such as possums, raccoons, rodents, deer, and even bears if they live in your area. There's nothing you can do about bears except bringing your feeders inside. Squirrels, possums, and raccoons can be prevented from climbing poles by installing baffles. These are cone-shaped and will tip, making it difficult for animals to get a good hold. The best kind are made of metal, such as these, which can't be chewed through and will last many years. Baffles can also work for feeders hung from tree branches. The baffle is placed between the branch and the top of the feeder. Raise the feeders. To prevent squirrels from reaching them from a ground jump, make sure the baffle is at least 4 feet off the ground, and feeders are at least 5 feet off the ground. Place the feeder pole at least 10 feet away from other objects of similar or greater height. Squirrels can jump great distances horizontally. Also, don't place bird baths close to the feeder poles. Animals, especially squirrels, can use them as a launching platform. Shrubs and bushes nearby can create the same problem. Also, place feeder poles less than 3 feet or greater than 10 feet from your house. It's less likely birds will hit windows. To make window glass easier for birds to see, consider adding ultraviolet reflective dots or lines to the glass. Dots or lines should be spaced apart at 2 inches by 2 inches and applied on the outside. Another option is mixing the food in hot sauce. Birds have fewer taste buds than mammals, and the burning sensation of capsaicin doesn't seem to bother them. This hot sauce is available pre-packaged from several companies. Just be careful not to breathe it, get it on your skin or in your eyes. That does it for today's video. Let me know in the comments below if you found other bird feeding mistakes to avoid. And here's that other video detailing how to deter stinging visitors at feeders. Make sure you don't miss out on future videos by hitting that subscribe button.